We'll start in the book of Psalm chapter 18. Psalm the 18th chapter. And then we're going to back up into Genesis chapter 26. Psalm chapter 18. Amen. Hallelujah. Oh, Boudreaux and Thibodeau was in a little P-Row. P-Row is a little boat, if you don't know. And Boudreaux asked Thibodeau, he said, why is it every time they go scuba diving, the guy got the gear on, and he sits there, and he falls back into water. Why he do that? And Thibodeau said, Boudreaux, you're so dumb. If he fell forward, he'd still be in the boat. Are you comfortable? Mm-hmm. You know what's funny is jokes ain't got to be dirty to be good. Amen. You just got to have the right crowd to share them in. Hallelujah. Psalm chapter 18, verse 19. King David talking. He said, he brought me out into a spacious place. He rescued me because he delighteth in me. Let me say that again. He brought me out into a spacious place. He rescued me because he delights in me. If there's one thing to try to get into all of our heads and hearts is to understand how much God really loves you. On the extent that he went to care for you and how much that Jesus would die for you again. Let's read it out of the message. It says, he stood me up on a wide open field. I stood there saved, surprised to be loved. Have you ever felt surprised to be loved? That somebody would just love you? Amen. Pastor Mike told me this morning, my pastor, he said, there's so much good in the worst of us and so much bad in the good of us. How do you say? There's so much worst in the good of us and there's so much good in the worst of us that we ain't got no business pointing a finger at one another. Amen. We all got issues. The issue here, David said, that he was surprised to be loved. Verse 20, he said, God made my life complete when I placed all the pieces before him. When I got my act together, he gave me a fresh start. Amen. That's the next verse out of the message. And I like mentioning the message because even on Friday, I talked about the Message Bible and I read it and a guy came up to me and said, where was that at, man? I got to find that Bible because it speaks. That's just spoke to my heart. And I said, that's good. I want to talk to you this morning about wide open spaces and how that God, and when a wide open space doesn't necessarily mean God's going to give you a home on 20 acres. It means God's going to give you some room to grow. Amen. Going to give you some space. And I think in life, particularly right now with what we've dealt with over the last 2 years, the disputes, the arguments, the frustrations, God put us in some wide open spaces. Give us a place where we can breathe in Jesus' name. Everyone sit? Amen. God bless you. You may be seated. One of the things I've preached for years, and I believe it in my heart, that the believers of the Little Country Church and the believers of people that I know is the fact that resiliency, to be resilient. If you're going to get into wide open spaces, you need to be resilient. Resiliency is a condition whereby one actually enlarges their capacity to handle problems. You ever notice that some people, when they're put in a straight place, in a problem, they can make things better, and others just fall apart. Others just can't seem to handle it. But God's people, I really believe in my heart that he makes us resilient, able to recoil or spring back into shape after bending, stretching. Amen. That's what resiliency does. It made David, King David. It made Abraham. It made Simon Peter. It made Saul the Apostle Paul. It was resiliency. The problem most of us run into is this thing today that is called, they consider wrist lock. It's what the pandemic has done to us. It's locked us down. We've even heard the term to lock down, to stay home, a condition that leaves us unable to do anything or go anywhere. Remember, guys, everything in life is risky. Drinking tap water is risky. If you live in Detroit, amen. It doesn't matter. But I was raised up drinking out of a green hose. Amen. I just loved it. I'm going to say this again to you over and over again. If you're looking for absolute safety, you're in the wrong species. It's not a part of our lives. Amen. There's no safety here where we're at. That's why I'm reminded of our assignment here and just how resilient God's people can be through misunderstandings, attempting to wave walk, or having people dig dirt from useless wells and throwing it on each other, flood after flood. Over the years, I've watched myself and others in this house bounce back again and again. One of the things I've noticed about resilient people is they continually seek to reassert some command and control over your life. If you don't take control over your life, somebody else will. Amen. Or a government will. take control over your life. Amen. You should do that. Resilient people have a larger than usual capacity. They might be called moral courage for refusing to betray their values. Amen. They find purpose and meaning in their suffering. Isaac is one of the most resilient people of the Old Testament. Amen. His difficult, amen, in life's journey, things were not easy after his father Abraham's death. His brother Ishmael, which of course is now the father of the Muslims, was bitter because Abraham gave Isaac the firstborn's inheritance. Then a famine came, and Isaac had to move his family to Gerar. There, hostile Philistines were cramming garbage in the wells that Abraham, his father, had dug. In Genesis 26, verse 18, Isaac reopened the wells that had been dug in the time of his father Abraham, which the Philistines had stopped up after Abraham died. Some folk are just mean, ain't they? They just throw trash in your well. I cannot throw trash out the window. Amen. I can't stand trash on the property. I can't stand it, man. I mean, it's God's property, God's place, and even my vehicle. I can only allow so much trash to be in it till I start cleaning it out every time I stop to get gas. I don't like to see it accumulate. And yet the Philistines, they would take and just throw trash. They'd walk by and thump a cigarette butt in the well. They'd spit in the well. They'd throw things in the well. That's my well. And you're throwing it off in there. Like, that's nasty. Isaac's servants dug in the valley and discovered a well of fresh water there. But the herdsmen of Gerar quarreled with Isaac, Isaac's herdmen, and said, "The water's ours." So he named the well Essek because they disputed with him. Then they dug another well, but they quarreled over that well also. So he named it Sitna. He moved on from there and he dug another well, saying, "Now the Lord has given us room in the land, and we will flourish there." He named it Rehoboth. In the time of Abraham and Isaac, owning one's well made you prosperous. If you had water, I mean, even today, when your water gets shut off, you go into a panic mode. Amen, because things in our home runs off that water. We got to have water. Amen, I was brought up with a well. We had wells. We had to learn how to prime the well. Amen. To keep that well working. We drew water out of the well. One day I remember we had a big well behind our house, and my dad would sit on that well. If you ever saw my dad sitting on the well playing his banjo, you left him alone. That was his time of solace and solitude. You didn't mess with Pop then. So he'd be sitting and playing but every now and then somebody would leave the lid of the well. It slid open. Dad had it set up with just a piece of plywood. You slid it open. It had the arch over it. You lowered the bucket. I know that sounds strange maybe for some. As soon as the bucket hit, it'd tilt sideways and fill up with water. You'd draw it up and you'd run it in the house. That's why I always said we had running water. We drew it up and ran it in the house. That was running water. So one day a chicken fell off in the well. Somebody left the lid open. The chicken went down in the well. How many know when a chicken get in the well, the chicken can't get out of the well. Chicken died, feathers everywhere. That's our drinking water. And I remember my dad going down in that well because he had steps down on the side. Is that big? Amen. He'd go down in the well with the bucket and put the dead chicken in it and put the chicken, the feathers in it. And mama would, and they would pour Clorox down in it. And I'll never forget one time my mama let go of the rope and the bucket went down and hit my daddy on top of the head. I'm going to confirm this story on my way back to the next campus when I talk to my mom. But I'm pretty sure it gashed him pretty good. And if you've ever heard anybody cursing in the bottom of a well, it has a certain echo to it, amen, a certain spirituality. You just want to get away from there because when you come up out of that well, it's not going to be good, amen. The truth of the matter is we drew water out of that well till it became fresh again because it was our only drinking source. If you lost the well, you're in trouble. Now, to have somebody throwing trash in your well, amen, to keep doing that over and over again. Again, if you had the water, you could care for your animals. You could grow crops. Amen. Water is life. Water is life. As long as we got, there are two things you cannot live without, and that's oxygen and water. Amen. You got to have water. Jesus fasted for 40 days. Amen. He could go without food for 40 days, but he couldn't go without water for 40 days. Amen. You got to be able to drink. Amen. To have that. So why would anyone want to stop up your well, the place of refreshing in life? First off, the scripture used the word, it's out of envy. Genesis 26, Isaac planted crops in the land, and the same year reaped 100-fold because the Lord blessed him. The man became rich, and his wealth continued to grow until he became very wealthy. He had so many flocks and herds and servants that the Philistines, there's that word, envied him. The word envy means discontent at another's superiority. They envied him. So all the wells that his father's servants had dug in the time of his father Abraham, the Philistines stopped up, filling them with earth. Whenever people desire what you have but refuse to go your route to get it, that's envy. It's envy. And here's our problem today, and I see it over and over, and it's when people, particularly, and I thank God for the next generation coming up, but when that generation sees what we got and they want what we got immediately, guys, it's the journey of getting here to where I'm at today that made me who I am. Amen. It was the TV with the vice grips on it that I turned the channel. It was getting up and going and changing the channel for my daddy when I was a little boy, or sticking my head out the door and turning the antenna with my hand like this with my foot in the air so he could pick up one of three channels. Amen. I didn't want to bypass none of that in my life. My life has been a series of difficulties that brought me to where I'm at. But I look back and I thank God for it. And I know that many people would want to shortcut process and move forward quickly and have what we got. But that will cause envy in your life. Amen. To want something somebody else has without going the route that they went. It's not about their things. It's their contented attitude that people envy. Amen. It's the fact that I can keep smiling no matter what's happening in life. And the fact that you can. It's the blessing of God. The peace you walk in. Envy desires to eliminate what it's focused on. If you are focused on somebody else's stuff and you envy them, I don't have time to preach this. But if Cain were Abel, he would have never killed Abel. Abel was content in his service toward God and the sacrifices he made. But Cain got in a situation where he envied Abel. And many times we envy. I can look at the singers and I don't have to envy them. I know I can't sing. Amen. And the joy of recognizing your own weakness. Can I say something, H? I know you can't dance. But I watch him try, and he makes fun of himself around the kids, and I love that. Amen. I mean, it's a honky hop, but still, it's a. And I'm the same way. I was trying to outdance JJ last week, and I cannot do it. Amen. I look very robotic. You know, in my mind, I am moving. You know what? I got it going on. And then I see a video, and I go, God help. Lord, you seeing what your servant looked like down here trying to dance? Amen. I look robotic down here. Help me, Jesus. So the bottom line is, I can't envy. I can encourage. I can be excited. But listen, the greatest thing you got, just learn how to be you. Thank God for who you are. Amen. Because if you're not careful, you begin to compete with others. And that's going to cause problems in your life. Just learn how to be you. Amen. It's a powerful feeling there. So what can stop up your will? Whenever you hold unforgiveness towards someone, we give place to the enemy of our soul to throw dirt in our well. It will produce a loss of joy. When people throw dirt in your well and you don't deal with it properly, or if you hold unforgiveness in your life, amen, and you it's going to cause a lot. Nobody wants to be around you when you have no joy. Life. Amen. We stop producing fruit in life. And then we dry up. We become useless to God and to the kingdom of God. Why do wells get contaminated? Verse 19, Isaac's servants dug in the valley and discovered a well of fresh water there. But the herdsmen of Gerar quarreled with Isaac's herdmen and said, the water is ours. But he named the well Essek because they disputed with him. Why do wells get contaminated? Disputing, arguing, fussing. Amen. They had fought over the water. Water, again, is provision. Provision always follows vision. Whenever you have a vision for something, here comes the vision with it. Spiritually blind people envy the fact you believe God for your well. I love the fact that God blessed Isaac. I think to myself sometimes, how is this going to happen? How is this going to work? And all I know is if God puts his finger on it, and if God favors it, and God blesses it, it's going to grow. Amen. Whether it be a church, it be a ministry, a business. But if I can get God's approval on it and get his hand on it, this thing's going to grow. It's going to take off. And that's what happened to Isaac. Amen. Everybody using the same fertilizer. Everybody using the same seed. Everybody using the same water. But Isaac's grew. I can't explain that to you other than the favor of God, and favor ain't fair. It ain't fair at all. It just happens. Philippians 2:14 tells us this. Do everything without grumbling or arguing so that you may become blameless and pure, children of God without fault in a warped and crooked generation. Can I tell you what generation we're in today and we'll be in tomorrow and the next year? Every generation has been a little warped and a little bit corrupt. Amen. Then you will shine among them like stars in the sky. Superstar. Thank you, Joseph. You caught that. Do everything without grumbling or arguing. Man, some folk just like to argue. They like to grumble. They like to complain. It's just something about them. There are folk that I know going to do that. I don't even want to talk to them. Amen. Because I know they're going to start an argument about it. There's no need arguing over this point. He says, do all things. Do everything without grumbling or arguing so that you may become blameless and pure. Amen. That way, I'm not like Essek here and disputing. Where there's provision, there needs to be supervision that connects back to the visionary. The dirt of disputes, petty arguments, three-year-old fightings. That's mine. Amen. We argue over brand names, best vehicles. And I know I pick. I'm aware of that. I pick on Fords and Chevrolets and Exalt Dodges a little bit. You know, we all do that. We all do that. Toyotas, whatever. We all do that. Amen. But the bottom line is don't go over extreme with your stuff. Amen. Realize that just don't. Churches. I'm Baptist. I'm Presbyterian. I'm Lutheran. And we wear them like a badge. Amen. I'm AG. I'm COC. I'm COGIC. I'm PCOG. I'm UPC. Amen. There's so many badges out there to wear. Stop arguing over it. Stop clogging up the wells. Amen. Move on. Amen. Get some wide open spaces. Can I get an amen? Amen. Then they dug another well, but they quarreled over that one also, so he named it Sitna. Sitna means hostility, hatred. God didn't design us to live with hostility and hatred. You need a wide open space. You need another space. God did not design you to stay among meanness and argumentative. Amen. Jesus said, if you hate your brother, you're guilty of murder. You've already murdered him in your own heart. It is becoming vividly clear to the medical world that bitterness is closely related to the cause of disease in the human body. Amen. It comes from offenses, disappointments, and rejection. If you stay bitter, if you stay that way, you get stressed. Amen. You start repeating things in your head. You can't let it go. And all of a sudden, your ulcers start forming and your heart starts acting up and everything inside of here. You know, I think sometimes being a biker saved me. So I get on my scooter, and it's like wide open spaces. Just whatever it is, it takes you into a place where God can bless you and look after you, and you can let go of the sickness and the Essex in your life, the disputes and the hostilities. Amen. Let me tell you, hurt that's not dealt with properly becomes bitterness. I've seen it with children. I've seen it with adults. Hurt that's not dealt with properly becomes bitterness. Bitterness contaminates others, becomes hatred, and leads to murder. People ask, what's wrong with the world today? We have a lack of Jesus. We really do. And I'm not trying to be religious. It's not about politics. It's about right and wrong. Amen. It's simply about, that's why I celebrate Texas and what Texas is doing now. Amen. Even among our government and protecting the unborn. So I sit back and say, God, what bitterness is not? Bitterness is not a fruit. It's a root. It goes down inside. It's a root that produces fruit. All roots begin with a seed. That seed could be a frustration, an aggravation, a continual picking. And one of the things as a guy I have to be careful of is just how far I can pick. Do you know, you ever know about some people got buttons? Some folk got buttons. Couples know one another's buttons. My greatest suggestion to anyone is hide your buttons. Amen. Protect your button. You know that's my button. Don't press that button. That button takes me back to my past. Amen. To my mistakes. You know all about that. I shared that with you, not so you could bring it up and hurt me with it. Amen. Cover that right there. Don't be hitting my buttons. Amen. Because what happens there is it goes into that seed. A seed is sown. Hurtful words, a supposed slight. Now, the pastor didn't shake my hand Sunday. I wonder if he's mad at me. me tell you, I have never not shaken somebody's hand because I was mad at them. Amen. It's an oversight. I just use me as an example. But sometimes people just get a little sly. You didn't get your birthday wish. That's why I'm nervous about social media. You know, some folks are, you know, they didn't say like. They didn't like my post. Maybe they didn't see your post. Amen. Maybe you need to quit acting like that's the end all of everything. Amen. Just let it go. How do I get wide open spaces? I want to help you. Get away from the TV. Quit watching the news. If you'll back off from the news, I promise you, just give it 5 days. 5 days, no news. You'll feel like a new person. Amen. You'll forget all the nonsense that's going on out there. All this stupid stuff. You'll never shout Brandon again. See, y'all watch the news too much. I was just a test there. That's all that was. Amen. The root grows down and produces fruit above. The seed has to germinate. You got to water it. If you're going to get bitter, you got to water it. Amen. You got to stay on it. You got to stay on the phone. You got to stay talking about it. You got to rehearse it over and over to get the seed to germinate. The soil has to receive it before it can produce from the soil. The soil determines the harvest. Your soul is your heart. Guard your heart, the scripture says, for out of it are the issues of life. Guard your heart. You don't want this well to be contaminated. And there are people that will come along and throw garbage in your well. You know where the well is? Right here. Oh, sometimes it's on this side, but usually it's on this side. And they'll say, come here, let me have your ear. And they'll start pumping garbage into your well. Amen. Let me tell you what, garbage in, garbage out. So beware of the garbage that comes into your ear, whether it be on the news, amen, or for somebody who wants to gossip and talk. Don't contaminate my well. I love fresh water, man. Hallelujah. I've always been against, I gave in. Bottled water. I don't know where that's bottled. I don't know if I believe the label. For some reason, one water is supposed to be better than the other water. Let me tell you, as a young boy raised up on the mountain, best water ever happened came right out of the creeks behind the house or the brooks. And if you could catch them coming up out of the ground, it was like a water fountain, man. Cold, fresh water. Hallelujah. And you just drink that water. Enjoy that water. Hallelujah. I don't want anything stopping up the well that God has put in here. How do I deal with it, Pastor? Ephesians 4:31. Let all bitterness and wrath and anger and clamor and evil speaking be put away from you with all malice. And be ye kind one to another, tenderhearted, forgiving one another, even as God for Christ's sake hath forgiven you. Who's that scripture talking to? Us believers. Amen. We need to forgive one another. Amen. Tenderhearted toward one another. Let all bitterness, let it. Everybody say, let. Say it again. See, I can't do it for you. You got to let it happen. Amen. You got to let it flow off your back like a duck's back. Amen. Let. It's something you have to do. Put away, to lift off, to remove, or take away, to move away from there. What do you do when there's disputing and hostility? Amen. You got to move to a wide open space. If necessary, you got to dig another well. Genesis 26:22, he moved on from there, Isaac did, dug another well, and no one quarreled over it. He named it Rehoboth, saying, now the Lord has given us room and we'll flourish in the land. You need to understand that Rehoboth simply means wide open space. Forgiveness gives you new territories, new beginnings. Unforgiveness keeps you in a tight place. If you can learn to let it go, let. Everybody say let. Let it go. Now the Lord has given us room and we will flourish in the land. I'll never forget when this scripture became alive to me. I was sitting out on the property in New Caney. I'd gone through disputes. I'd been the product of hostilities. Amen. And all kind of crazy things had happened. I had a man come to me when I was in San Antonio and said to me, the Lord is going to give you a place. I'll never forget this. Between churches, H. Man walked up to me and said, God showed me he's going to give you land, houses you've not built, and wells you've not dug. He's quoting out of Deuteronomy. And I thought, well, that's sweet of you to prophesy, but you better get away from me before I punch your lights out. Because I am mad. I'm upset about life. I don't want to hear it. Amen. And so then I went on my way. A year later, I'm in New Caney. out there on 110 acres. That same man walks through the doors of our church, looks at me and smiles. And it all came back to me. God's going to give you land, houses you ain't built, and wells you ain't dug. And here I sit on 22152 Baptist Encampment Road, 110 acres, with 19 buildings and wells I have not dug. Amen. God gave that to us. When he gave it to me, he gave it to us. Can I get an amen? Amen. So I've seen God do that over and over again. Sometimes you're in a bad place in your life, and you say, you know, I don't see that. Hang on. Hang on to the promise of God and wait and see what he does. Wide open places. Amen. He gave that to us. It was right after this experience that God appeared to Isaac and confirmed to him, and I'll start closing with this, to him the promise that he had given his father. I have to fight for our wells, our peace, our space, because the generation after us may receive what we've believed God and fought for. And that's my hope and prayer. Isaac received what Abraham believed God for. God told Isaac, I am the God of your father Abraham. Do not fear, for I'm with you. I will bless you and multiply your descendants for the sake of my servant Abraham. There are times that God will bless you because of your daddy. He will bless you because of your mama. Amen. There are times that I do funerals and I look over and I think of the blessing of the person that I just did the funeral for and what a blessing they were to their kids, and hoping they grasp hold the fact, amen, this thing is generational. Amen. It passes on. May our children be blessed because we didn't get bitter. Can I tell you something? You live bitter, your kids are going to live bitter. You mean you hate the church? Your kids will hate the church. Be careful even of our government. You know, again, there are things I don't like in our government, but I thank God for the United States of America. Amen. I love this nation. Amen. And I just stand proud to be an adopted Texan from Alabama. I thank God for all the good things that have come my way. But I want my kids to be blessed. I don't want to be mad and upset. So beware of what you say. All of us will encounter multiple obstacles on the road toward our promise. The contentious wells of Essex, dispute, and Sitna, hostility and hatred, they tend to drain the life out of us rather than provide any refreshing. Their waters are bitter. I've served and served with men and women who love God, and their own siblings hate them because they're blessed. Let me just tell you, you need to shake that off. You need to ask God for your own blessing. Amen. To get up and keep pressing on. I've seen it in my family. Amen. And now my family understands they're blessed because they just let it go. So you know what? I'm glad Jerry's blessed. Now I'm going to be blessed. Shifts and changes. The lesson here is simple. We got to keep walking by faith. Even when we feel trapped by the enemy, we got to keep pressing on. We must go over the next hill. You got to turn the next corner. You got to be resilient. Many of us have felt stalled in dry places. I've seen it in your life. You hit a dry place and you're stalled, and somebody's putting garbage in your ear. They say things to you. Quit listening. Matter of fact, can I encourage you? Move away from them. If you continually allow the same people to put garbage in your ear, aren't you a part of the problem? Shouldn't you just move away from it? Amen. Say, listen, I can't hear that no more. Amen. I'm very selective on my relationships in life. Very selective. I got to be around people that are positive, lifting up, encouraging. When I get around them people, amen, I feel like I can make it another day. I can press on. But beware of what comes into your ears. Amen. Psalm 18, one more time. They confronted me in the day of my disaster, but the Lord was my support. He brought me out into spacious place. He rescued me because he delights in me. The message, they hit me when I was down, but God stuck with me. He stood me up on a wide open field. I stood there saved, surprised to be loved. I am surprised to be loved. I am surprised to be loved.
You love me. You love these people here. You love these people here. God, I pray in the name of Jesus that we would move on from disputes, hostility, and unforgiveness. That there would be the ability to dig another well, to move into a Rehoboth, a wide open space. No more cramp, no more tightness. We rebuke bitterness in our life. We believe in the name of Jesus as we forgive and we release. God, some of us need to release you. That's right. Some people have held animosity against you, Father. They've asked, why did you allow this to happen? We release you now, God. We know that it doesn't change who you are. You've never done anything to hurt us. We'll see it on the other side. But this life is so full of hurt and pain. And there are people that say the wrong thing. Help us in the name of Jesus to move away from there. God, to move to wide open spaces. God, give us a place of peace, tranquility, serenity. I thank you, God, for doing that in Jesus' name. Amen. 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 Now take a quiet moment. Just receive all that. Let it run through your mind. Forgiveness. How could we call heaven ours unless we forgive? Lord, you forgave those who beat you, tortured you, spit upon you. And then you ask us to forgive as you have forgiven others also. Help us release them right now in Jesus' name. Hallelujah. Heal hurts in this house. Those watching online. The Holy Spirit put a Band-Aid over it. Help us hide our buttons. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Help us grab a shovel and just start digging another well. Move on away from hostility. Quit fighting with the Philistines. Move to a wide open space. In Jesus' name. In Jesus' name. Amen. 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 I thank you for coming today. I encourage you to invite folk to church next week. I still believe this house can be full at 8:30 in the morning. I still believe that. Amen. Hallelujah. I know it's hunting season. I'm aware of that. You're aware of that. So if God blesses you out there hunting, don't forget the storehouse. Get back here to the house. With that being said, our servant leaders will come up. One day I think somebody's going to drop a back strap in one of these buckets. Amen. If you need to tithe or offer an envelope, they're on the pew in front of you. Please reach and get one. If you're giving on the phone, amen, online, you can go to holywild.net/give. We thank you for your faithfulness in giving. Amen. Next Sunday night, I'll make this one announcement, and then Pastor David can make the rest. But next Sunday night, we will have a trunk or treat. Amen. It's up to you to make this successful. Amen. To come out, that just simply means that you open up your trunk, throw a bunch of candy in it, and kids get to show. It's so simple. Amen. But the kids have a secure place to come. Amen. We'll be setting up on the other side of the fence. Amen. And folk can come in and bring their kids in and let them get some candy. And it'll be a secure thing from 6 to 8 o'clock next Sunday night. So we'll announce it again Sunday. And some folk really come and they dress out. They got this thing down. Amen. This is not a day that I celebrate as far as the foolishness that goes on. But I believe for those that do want to bring their kids out, there needs to be a secure place for them. So we'll do that for them next week, 6 to 8. Amen.